I would like to present John. This is a great honor for us, John, to have you with us. John Gartenberg is a film archivist, distributor, programmer, and curator, president of the Gartenberg Media Company for Experimental Cinema Distribution. While working for nearly two decades as a curator in the Museum of Modern Arts Department of Film, he acquired numerous avant-garde films for the permanent collection. His signature projects include restoring the films of Andy Warhol and editing and publishing catalog of MoMA Archival Film Collection. John has also authored many articles on film history and on preservation, including The Fragile Emulsion, published in several publications, and we sent the beautiful piece to our students in the previous days, the past days. And John asked me to start his talk with a great transition from Barbara's talk, with showing a clip from the filmmaker Warren Sonbert, which John will address in his talk. It's a film called Where Did Our Love Go? From 1966, and I'm going to show a short clip. It's a short clip filmed in MoMA and the MoMA galleries. Please, everyone, if you can mute.
Very good.
Okay, so I'm sharing the screen. I'm showing the showing from my computer. Where did our love go? So please have a warm welcome to Jon Gartenberg.
Thank you, Sharon. So I wanted to thank Sharon, the head of the department, also Vivian Ostrovsky, because Sharon said that Vivian had recommended when she come to New York to meet me, and we met in the restaurant attached to the Film Society of Lincoln Center, and we started chatting, and Sharon was very interested in the history of video, but also the history of film, because they're moving image works and time-based, but they have really kind of different histories and origins. And she thought it would be a good idea to bring this discussion together, which I think is a great idea, because in my mind, it's not always fully discussed. And just as an aside, like when I go to galleries and see video art projected, sometimes I look at the wall labels and I think, oh, but that issue that they're raising in the wall label, like it's been in an experimental film world like 30 or 40 years ago. And so I think sometimes there isn't enough interactivity for both the experimental film world and experimental video world to really converse about their histories. So I'm gonna basically go over a number of things. I'm gonna touch upon topics. I'm not going to necessarily go into real depth. I'm going to tell some also funny anecdotes. My goal in this is because it's paying homage to Barbara and her wonderful work, her book, and knowing her from about 1973 or 74. So I'm going to kind of try to talk with this to anchor my discussion and what she talked about. For example, that clip that you just saw from Warren Sonbert's Where Did Our Love Go? Is from 1966. And I wanted to show that because he was an experimental filmmaker and a student at NYU who started making films in that year. And it relates to Barbara, where she was talking about, what was it, Barbara, in 65, it was the video cameras that became available. So just to give you an idea of picking something sort of contemporaneous to what Barbara talked about, I think is a good sort of anchor point. So I also, that clip was from Where Did Our Love Go? And that's a walk through MoMA's galleries. He used his friends and students at NYU. And I thought that would be a great starting point since Barbara and I both worked at MoMA. And that's just a few years before we started there. And the first thing I wanna really touch upon is what Barbara was dealing with, because I think it's a kinship we've talked about. When Barbara talked about feeding the soul, and this is where I get a little emotional, because sometimes now I think that curators, it's all become like kind of a job. Sometimes it's not rigorous. It's kind of put something on the screen or acquire something, but not really being rigorous with themselves about what they're doing and why they're doing it. And I think Barbara and I both share that kind of idea. We don't approach these things casually as like from an egotistical point of view. We're approaching it from a point of view of sort of deference to the artists and trying to understand what's going on. My experience of this also was how these filmmakers really touch my soul and inspire me. And one of the experiences I had after MoMA was programming experimental films for the Tribeca Film Festival, which was started by Robert De Niro. And it was kind of subversive because I had my own sort of perch to show these films, and they would be either established filmmakers or young filmmakers. But there was something about these films that just deeply moved me and deeply touched me. And the other thing I would say is I'm not a filmmaker. I made films at Cornell University in undergrad, and I archived them away because they were so terrible. But I think that that gave me some kind of at least objectivity in the sense of certain filmmakers are also involved in certain institutions. And I think sometimes it's a critique, not a criticism, but sometimes, you know, their own desire for their own films to be highlighted can sometimes, have an effect on how they approach what they do. And the other thing I wanted to say about Barbara is a couple of experiences. One is that when I started at MoMA, my first job was to catalog films in the collection, and that was at age 21. And like, what's more exciting than getting paid to watch movies? But I remember very distinctly, like the first time I met Barbara, since I was cataloging and Barbara was pioneering, setting up the video department in MoMA. And the cataloging at that point was being added to MoMA's collection. And I remember going to Barbara's office, and I remember Vertical Roll, which was one of the acquisitions, and we talked about cataloging it. The other thing I wanted to say about Barbara was, the other thing that she would do sometimes, because MoMA ended at 5:30, and I remember we did numerous things. She'd say, John, do you want to go around town? And she had a whole thing mapped out. So we'd start at like the American Federation of Arts, and we'd go to like a holiday party there. And then she said, oh, I know there's this artist that's doing something in a loft space, like let's go there. And then there was like a third or fourth place to go. And so by midnight we had visited four places, and it was really fun to do it with Barbara. But also the other thing I wanted to convey is this was a time that was very exciting. And I think Barbara's conveyed it in a way, like she was very pioneering in what she was doing in this institution. And it required also, as I felt, in my dealing with experimental films, you have to be a little bit subversive. I mean, my subversive aspect was more at the Tribeca Film Festival, which was completely commercial, but that for 11 or 12 years, I could show experimental works. So there's something about taking on the ethos of these filmmakers or video artists who don't fit easily into certain molds. Yes, they're artists, and yes, they've worked in other media, but there's something about the form which sort of cuts against the standard commercial grain. To go to experimental film, at age 23, when I was 23 years old, MoMA got a $33,000 grant from the Jerome Foundation for experimental films to be acquired for the collection. To explain also, Barbara was a one-person show within the film department for video. When I was in the film department, at that point, it was very divided. And I don't mean divided like antagonistically divided, but there was a curator of programming who was Adrian Mancha, and there was a curator of the archive who was Eileen Bowser. So I worked in the archive department. I ended up doing exhibitions, but my basic focus was on the archival aspects of film work, which has to do with collection and preservation and is a very different practice, although related to film programming. Also, I was a curatorial assistant then, and I had pretty much free rein to acquire the experimental films for the permanent collection, which would never happen today. I mean, a curatorial assistant helps the curators, but at that point, I was able, my boss who was the curator, looked over my shoulder, but I basically had a lot of free rein. But I took the job very seriously because most of these films, as some of you may know at that point, were made by filmmakers on, and it had to do with the economy of shooting and developing the film, were made on 16 millimeter reversal. But I was acquiring films for the permanent collection of MoMA. There were other films that were for 16 millimeter that were for the circulation collection or for the study collection. So I felt that my mission was serious in the sense that I had to think about what was the tradition of the MoMA and what was the tradition of experimental film at MoMA. So basically the grant was given to, Barbara mentioned, like there was CineProbe, which started in the 60s to acquire films of filmmakers that were shown in CineProbe. And then I expanded that out. But to do that, I did extensive research. I read through, and here's the difference, where Barbara was dealing with video art that was just emerging, I had to deal with like decades and decades of film history beforehand. So to look at like what the gaps were in the past, but also stay abreast with the present. So I did research going back to Iris Barry, who was the first curator of the film department in 1935, reading the MoMA bulletins, Richard Griffith, who was a curator, who wrote an article in 1956, where he talked about experimental film. Then Willard Van Dyke took over and I started with working with him, and he was a filmmaker and the head of the department and also was a supporter of experimental film. So I really wanted to understand the tradition into which I was working. And one of the first acquisitions at MoMA was Ballet Mécanique, which is the Fernand Léger film. And so the tradition that I was dealing with was modern art, which deals with the issues of time and space and the representation of it. And I wanted to kind of carry on that tradition. And in doing my research, of course, I found that European avant-garde films were shown in San Francisco. Sidney Peterson was involved, and there were some other filmmakers. And so I wanted to kind of put some shape onto what I was acquiring. And I realized that there were very few or almost no Sidney Peterson films, nor James Broughton, who worked with Peterson on a couple of movies. So sort of the anchor of the collection was acquiring Sidney Peterson and James Broughton films, like I think it was four of each of theirs. And then expanding into that, looking at other filmmakers' works who had not been necessarily acquired, which included like Jonas Mekas. There was some Stan Brakhage, but an increasing more of Stan Brakhage and a lot of other filmmakers, because I was looking primarily at the post-war period, which of course is abstract expressionism. So in a way, in the MoMA context, it was like, how were these experimental filmmakers dealing with abstraction? And that started my journey. I also looked at the MoMA information show in 1970, when there were prints of Ernie Gear and a few prints of Ken Jacobs, but I expanded the collection of Ernie Gear films, for example. The other formative experience for me was I took at NYU P. Adam Sitney's class. P. Adam Sitney is one of the great theoreticians of the avant-garde. This is one book he wrote, which is called Eyes Upside Down. And he actually, it's not upside down. He actually did a chapter on Warren Sonbert after I did a show of Warren Sonbert films at the Guggenheim, which was fascinating for me because there were other revelations that he had about Sonbert based on the exhibition there. And he really taught experimental film. There's the structural tradition, there's the mythopoeic tradition. And I think this addresses maybe what one of the people had mentioned earlier on. I didn't take that kind of approach. I was much more open to kind of looking at the works and seeing what was represented in them. So for example, in acquiring a number of films, there was the social and political documentaries from 1972. I wasn't putting it in this larger categories that Sitney did, but I was looking at the work and seeing what were themes or ideas that were emerging. Another example is I did a contemplation of the photographs by putting a film by Michael Snow, 1 Second in Montreal, together with acquiring Hollis Frampton's Nostalgia, because they were both dealing with still images, but in very different ways. So I was always trying to look at like what was emerging as I was seeing these films and how to maybe put them together to when I was programming to compare and contrast them. Then what happened is I began to expand to other filmmakers. I primarily started with France, acquired films by, for example, Jan Beauvais, and I mentioned Vivian Ostrovsky. The other thing that then happened, because I worked at MoMA for 18 years, is I realized that I was acquiring these reversal prints, but what about the camera originals? So I began to acquire camera originals of films by Warren Sonbert, short films by Mark Rapaport. I didn't get to do much preservation on those because at that point I left MoMA. But the other big project I worked on was conserving Andy Warhol's films. And that was another big project. So basically, to condense my talk more, my projects were dealing with the acquisition, preservation of the films. And of course I did programming. And when I left MoMA, I continued doing that. And I wrote this article called The Fragile Emotion, which I recommend you read because one of the main tenets of it is that the approach to preserving experimental films to me has to do with understanding the artist's process, how the artists work in terms of making the preservation decisions. And as distinct from like experimental film artists could often deal with multiple versions of the same film, like Sonbert made three versions of Carriage Trade. And that's in opposition or contradistinction to the commercial cinema where everything is fixed in a form to be mass distributed. So I will just focus on Sonbert here because my time is limited. But the other reason why I'm bringing up Warren Sonbert is because Barbara was talking about how these artists are not limited to one area. Like he was considered an experimental filmmaker, but he was also an opera critic. He wrote a full-length opera to Capriccio. He also had an influence on experimental poets. When I showed his films in Philadelphia, a couple of experimental poets came, and it was very poignant because they said the thing they were envious about Warren Sonbert was that, you know, people had to read poetry from left to right, but Sonbert could turn the image upside down. You know, he could do all sorts of things. And it's really fascinating to get the insight when you have artists from other fields like language to talk about an experimental filmmaker and how they read into all of that. The other thing about Sonbert is he dealt with the art world. He photographed in Where Did Our Love Go? For example, there are scenes in Warhol's factory. There's a art show of Tom Wesselman's work that he shot also in the Castelli and Janus galleries. He shot at the Bleecker Street Cinema. In Hall of Mirrors, he filmed Gerard Malanga, who was a Warhol superstar, in Lucas Samaras's mirrored room sculpture. So it's just to say that Sonbert was also anchored in the arts, which I think was part of Barbara's point. It's not necessarily that the experimental filmmakers were all in their own ivory tower, even though they could work independently and make their films as Sonbert did independently. He was still surrounded and influenced by this whole art world. So I think my time is getting near the end. Is that right, Sharon? I have a couple of minutes. Yeah. So I think what I want to do now is, and I'll just add one thing, is to show a clip. A trailer that my colleague who works with me, Fred Rydell, put together, who also is involved with the art world, worked at the American Federation of Arts, and he collaborates with our company now. There's clips from three films by Warren Sonbert, Amphetamine, Where Did Our Love Go, and Hall of Mirrors. And also you can see these films online if you go to my company's website, www.gartenbergmedia.com. We've just set up a new section of the website called Streaming, because in my career, I thought I'd never have to go from celluloid to digital, which I did, to DVD. And then I thought, oh my God, now I have to learn about streaming and go into streaming. But this is the launch of our streaming site, and you can see those three films in their entirety. And I'd also say in relationship what Barbara said about COVID, it's interesting because one of the films, Where Did Our Love Go, which you'll see, is in all of these art gallery setting, and it's a lot of people together. Then you're going to see a clip from Hall of Mirrors, which is another Warhol superstar, Rene Ricard. And he's alone with this pop soundtrack and with a flower, you know, it's a lost love. So he's kind of like the isolation of COVID. And then the last clip you're going to see is from Amphetamine, which is Sonbert's first film, which is all about sex, drugs, and rock and roll. And you're going to see a scene of two boys kissing. This is directly an homage to Alfred Hitchcock's Vertigo, because Sonbert was seeing films when he was a teenager. When he was a teenager, he published articles on an interview with Jean-Luc Godard. He published an article on Alfred Hitchcock, and he had a career retrospective by the time he was 20. And Variety, the newspaper of the commercial cinema, said not since Andy Warhol's Chelsea Girls has there been such an event with such a buzz around it. So what's been exciting for me is to excavate now. This is just his first three works. They're not what he's really known for. He's known for his silent montage films, but this is part of the joy of and the challenge of being a curator, is to really dig and dig deep into work and discover things and try to expose them. So now, Sharon, I think if you can show the film, and that'll be.
We'll show it. And if you can put the link to your streaming site on the chat, it would be amazing. If not, I will distribute it later to the students. Okay, so I'm sharing the screen.
Okay.
It's a 3-minute clip.
I've waited so long for your kisses and your love. Please come to me from up above.
Come softly, darling. Come softly.
That's it.
That was the clip. Is it missing the last part?
Well, those are clips from the three films. I mean, this one, I mean, I just wanted to show some essence because you said, you know, we didn't have time to show like an 8-minute or 10-minute, but I wanted to give a little bit of the flavor because it's also the 1960s. You know, he used all his friends to film and his students at NYU and Warhol superstars and all of that. So there's a lot more to these films and there's a lot more I can say to it, say it. That film is modeled in a way after Hitchcock's Vertigo, because the opening of the film shows A Portrait of a Woman, which is like Carlotta Valdez. And so in Vertigo, when Jimmy Stewart goes in and sees Kim Novak looking at a picture with the, her hair in a curl. I should also mention that thanks to Vivian also, through her Hollywood series, that we presented a retrospective with Chen Scheinberg, who I think is in your department. We co-organized a program, which was a couple years ago. We showed at the Jerusalem Cinematheque and the Tel Aviv Cinematheque, which was Warren Sonbert in Hollywood, because Warren was well-versed in Hollywood films. And I think as a filmmaker, he is experimental filmmaker. He's kind of unique, because even though other experimental filmmakers like Jonas Mekas and Ken Jacobs know a lot about Hollywood film, Warren in his was less, he had abstractionist films, but he was less concerned with abstraction as with narrative structure. And he was trying to create a narrative structure in an experimental manner that paralleled commercial cinema. And he has gazillions of references in specific shots, like in that last one I showed you, or in the overall structure of his films. One of his films is modeled after a Douglas Sirk movie, and another one after Alfred Hitchcock. So you can see various tropes, all sorts of things. And, you know, this is like, I acquired Warren Sonbert's Amphetamine early on at MoMA, and that was back in 1970, I don't know what. And since he passed away, unfortunately, of AIDS in 1995, and I worked on a project with the Estate Project for Artists with AIDS to preserve his film. So, you know, I've been working with a number of filmmakers, you know, in Tribeca Film Festival and so on, but I've been working with his films for 25 years. And one thing we did, and this is just to show you like what Barbara does and just to give you an idea, but this is a special issue of Framework, which I was guest editor of, the Harvard Film Archive and the Harvard Libraries acquired all of Warren Sonbert's papers. And this is a book, all of Warren Sonbert's writings. And I think what's really important here is, because it has to do with respect for the artist, like this is his screenplay for Capriccio, but we reproduced everything as he originally wrote it. So it wasn't like, you know, resetting the text and things like this. So it's what makes it even more fascinating. I'll just see if I have one more quick thing I can show you. Like this is the shot list for his films, you know, and he had things marked out and so on forth and so on. So what I was talking about the artist process, like instead of making this nice and neat, you know, typeset, I mean, this is the material that he used on his typewriter. So it's more of the fabric of, like Barbara talked about, the ephemera, which is, I completely agree, this is all important material in terms of how he thought, what he did, how he created what he did.
John, thank you very much. It was really fascinating.